give a warm welcome to Linus.
Ja, es freut mich, dass ihr
I'm happy that so many of you have come and fell victim to this title. So I've decided to call it Hacking Brains. Background to this is, as soon as you talk about hackers, there's this image of half-gods in black and nobody knows what's going on, but they somehow gain access and they're inside my technological devices. But it's actually quite different than most people think. So I have the thesis that every practical problem in IT security has been already solved in theory. So we're not really lacking the knowledge of how to do IT security. We just somehow can't manage to do it. So the practical IT security is a disaster. Reason for that is that we kind of built up interesting buildings, and this looks very secure, like there's fences, and it looks very secure, but in reality, this is what happens. That's a very small issue here. But yeah, we can imagine that with a bigger issue, that would be quite different. We're reading a lot about Emotet right now. Hackers compromise computers, and they want to have money. And Heise has been writing about that a lot until they fell victim to it. When we look at research on IT security, especially here too, that's why I'm doing this here, it has to be avant-garde and has a lot of applause and be big. And in reality, it's more like, did I do it already? Am I in? So as hackers, we kind of think it's interesting to live in the world like on the left side, that academia thing, where in reality it's more like a gamble. So one of the problem areas we have, which we can see everywhere, basically, we're not really attending for that. So I want to talk about simple scams, about password security issues, all that kind of stuff. One scam that's been known to the CCC quite well was a scam from the Chaos Hacking Group. They send around emails telling people that they've hacked their sites and know a lot of private information about them and ask them to send them their Bitcoin wallet. No, they give them their Bitcoin wallet and ask them to send them money in order to not distribute that information. And people think it can't really be that they know that. How do they know? So we need proof for that. Otherwise, we're not going to pay. But if someone tries to gain access to money from people, to get money in that way.
Okay, so if people are trying to Google if this is a true threat or not, they are going to a website which tries to infect them with an additional Trojan. So people are going from rain into the next problem. I know you wanted to be scammed, so here's a little bit of snake oil for you to download. So people who don't have the training, it's very dangerous. So let's look at people who have the training, the Linux kernel mailing list. Many of you may know it. an email arrived, changed your... So it's a... It is been from October 2018, so it mentioned the password, and people are supposed to be very afraid because their password is mentioned, and they wanted to get Bitcoin from the Linux kernel developers. Bitcoin is quite nice. You can check the blockchain. There's 2.98 Bitcoins. That's about 19,000 euro for a few days ago. So nobody can say that you can't make money using Linux. And the email obviously went to a lot of more people, not on the Linux kernel mailing list. But given that you can make easy money so easily, you're asking yourself, why are we doing what we're doing? There's also the classic of CEO fraud, one of the scenarios that companies are afraid of. You get an email that says, hey, we have to pay the invoice, we have to do it today. And one of the ways to do it is there's a small amount which easily passes, and you can also do it in an advanced level. Where there's well, the big deal with the Chinese is impending. You're not supposed to talk to anyone, but you have to transfer 2.4 million to the Seychelles. And people actually do it, and they use authority and trust, and they ask people to do what they are not supposed to do. And it looks kind of funny, but if you talk to someone who's happened, who has this happen to them, have a big crisis because it's obviously very bad for the company, and it's not that funny anymore. So let's go back to something funny. The authentication. It's something that's hard for a lot of people, their password, and they only have one password, which shows up in collections such as collection 1-5, which we all carry them with us, so we can just look at the passwords. And the nice thing about these lists is that even us that we are, if you put my email address into Have I Been Pwned, where you can check if the email address is contained in leaks, you will also find my email address in there. And I may talk about later how I may have end up in there. So computers haven't really ever solved the password problem. We tell people you are not supposed to be able to guess it. It should be as long as possible, not only a word, and it needs to be different for all the sites. And nobody does that. Because I went to the dentist recently, and he said, well, you have to use dental floss 3 times a day. And then I say, well, use different passwords everywhere, and then we can talk again. And yes, I actually did that. And I'm now using a password manager, and we know this is smart. But I'm trying to tell people of password managers for many years, and the reaction is always the same. It's always the fuck. And we never managed to go beyond use password managers, and they ask me which one, and they say I don't recommend any. And the question is, how do people get these passwords? They either create a service and then they hack a service and then extract the passwords, or they just send you an email and ask for it. Here's a nice example that I got yesterday. I selected it yesterday because I actually fell victim to it. Yes. PayPal, important message, wants to tell me that the system has seen an unauthorized access to the account, To guarantee your security, please push this button. And the nice thing about this is there's only one button. And that alone should make you feel weird. Also the fact that the address wasn't PayPal, but I was kind of tired and I clicked on it. And here's what saved me. My password manager couldn't offer me a password for this page. So
okay, so I didn't show which password manager it was. Don't think that I find this great, because this password manager got an update recently, and if I would do this, but I don't know the site, but maybe you want to input your credit card number or your address. Yeah, thank you very much. No, I don't like this password manager. I can do without it. If you look at phishing sites, well, it's not really magic. If you take a website, copy it to another server, and program a little backend that collects all requests, and I found this for the Gmail webmail login, a very nice one here. And I really found that quite elegant what they did. So they took this one, the domain, from the email address, and you send it along as a GET request, and in their source code, they have the fav icon from that domain, looked it up on Google, and so if you use another domain, it's always another logo. Well, so it looks more convincing, really. If you look at it, the probability of success for these mass emails is very, very low. It's really tiny. And all these mails will be sent million-fold and to many recipients. But if you really send so many emails, and even if you get stuck in many spam filters, you still find a victim who enters his password. And we have a nice story. This is really mass mail thing, bulk email thing. If you look into your spam folder, and you will find these emails. It's stupid if they don't land in the spam. That's really bad. So now we talked about bulk email attacks, targeting the best of us. But if we really do it targeted, then we don't talk about phishing, but about spear phishing. And you don't send millions of emails, but you send exactly one to exactly that person of which you want to have the password. And you create a story fitted exactly to that person. So, for example, the way I like to do it is password reset mails. Many companies do that every employees have to change the number at the end of the password and increment it by one. So you get an email about that. And the email login from most of the companies, you don't really fake it. I already have it. So if you do spear phishing, you have a probability of maybe 30%, so that the targeted person goes to the site and enters the password. If you do it with three people, then I have a business case. And especially, I have no spam filter that is in my way. I can set up mail servers with slightly different domain names, and they have a Let's Encrypt web certificate on the website, and everything works, and it usually goes through. And I'll come back to that problem, because I would really like to solve that. But even if it's about distributing malware, it's a target that is really liked, not using zero-day exploits, but really offer the software to the people and see how they install it. THS talked about a tweet, and I looked it up, and it's really true. Sometimes, as an IT guy, you feel like a sheep, like shepherd, but sometimes the sheep are drunk, and they are burning, and they click on everything. That's by @Celilander. Okay. Recently, who listened to Thorsten's talk, who knows that we did something with a torrent, and I was with the drive-by Paralympics here, and I went to a website that really urged me to install something. I had to do an update, some strange plugins, and people just do that. Yeah, really, it's really, normally people sit in my office and say, yeah, I have a virus. Yeah, how do you know that? Yeah, well, it said so. Yeah. And then they just installed something, and then they realize, that's probably not so smart, and now they have dozen malwares that claim they remove malware. And that's exactly how FinSpy, the state Trojan, worked like that. They made a nice website. Hey, come on, click on this. You can download something here. And the analysis did Thorsten together with Ralf Burmeier this morning. And now we are at the... A round of applause for Thorsten, please. Now we have arrived at the problem which since about 2016 has been troubling the world, and that is ransomware. It's relatively simple. You get an email. In the email is some attachment. In this example, we did that in 2016. It's Locky, and it's an invoice. And if you open the attachment, the following happens. You get this one, and the program Microsoft Word is opened. And Microsoft Word has two warnings for you. You can see them in yellow and in pink on the screen. And the red warning says it isn't an unlicensed Word version. And so either you haven't got it or you have it and got used to it. And the yellow warning is warning you that you are about to shoot yourself in the foot very much. And this warning is very simple to understand. Be careful. Files from the internet can contain viruses. Unless you need to edit, it's safer to stay in protected view. And so consistently, there's a button consistent with the warning, enable editing. Everybody understands what it is, and the danger, the potential of danger is clear. And just like with the PayPal phishing email, there's this huge button, and on the top right corner, very small, it's almost hidden. You almost didn't see it. There's a little gray cross, and that's really the way to safety, to security. But of course, you are trained to press this button because this warning pops up every time you open Microsoft Word, because there's always a macro in the Word document in your company that's flying around your company. It's not that bad. Microsoft Word has another warning for you, and that's this security warning: macros have been disabled. And now you say enable content. And in this Locky, we sit in this empty page without content. And what we need is content, so we enable the content. And on the desktop, I put some files on the desktop here, which are lying around here. And if I press the button, what happens? All the files are gone. The macro that was in this document is loading via a simple GET request an exe file, and executes lock key, and lock key erases the hard disk and encrypts the disk. Oh, and when it's done, then by the way, it says, oh, your files are encrypted. And if people say encrypted, they think, oh, can't you decrypt it? And so that says, no, you can't. No. It would be nonsense if we could decrypt things that are encrypted, and that's why we did it right. And there's a website, and it explains where you can transfer how many bitcoins, and they were quite generous. It was only 500 euros at that time, and Locky was the first big ransomware wave, and everybody warned to not to open invoices, and it didn't improve the balances of the attackers. And there were emails like this. They looked like this. Hello, this is the federal police, and please be careful of Locky, because many people asked how to protect, and we have a brochure about this, and you find it as an attachment. And all the fun started from the beginning. Locky was 2016, and a short time ago we looked at it, how it looked with GantCrab. That was a ransomware from... I tell you in a minute where they came from a group who retired recently. With the words, we showed that you can make millions with criminal actions, and then you can just retire, and we encourage you to lead the same wonderful life as we do, and we are retiring. And if we did the same thing with that, you landed on this website, and very nice, with many psychological tricks. And at the top said, if you don't pay within a week, then the price will double. And they looked it up at booking.com. They copied it from there. And then they'll explain, it's encrypted, you get it only back from us, and there's a nice service, free decrypt. You can send a single file there, and they decrypt it and send it to you, so to prove to you that they can decrypt it. So they're really, really good businessmen and show that you can do it. They're honest people, and they have a chat, and they have a customer chat, and we were sitting together with our Windows VM that we had just gantrapped, and thought, oh, come on, let's chat with them. And we played dumb a little bit. Hello, we cannot buy the Bitcoin. And they sent us links where we can get Bitcoins. Oh, it's too much effort. Can't we just make a SEPA transfer, and we'll pay the fees? That's fine. And then we couldn't think of anything else. Then I said to my friend Vladimir, hello Vladimir, ask them if they speak Russian. And they could. The answer was, of course, yeah. Of course, they answered in Cyrillic, Cyrillic immediately. And we had the German keyboard and there with the Cyrillic letters. And they were very interested in, hey, you are Russian, very interesting. How have you been infected? How could that happen? This says you are in Germany. And then I asked, so you are in Germany, and so on. And we said, oh yeah, I work for Gazprom. And they became more and more friendly, and they wrote this sentence, and I put it into Google Translate to translate it for you. And it's, brothers, take a photo of your password in the background of this chat. You can cover important information with your fingers if you want. I just need confirmation that you're a citizen of the Russian Federation. If you are a citizen of the Russian Federation, we will send you a free decryptor. Sometimes it's really IT security just to have the right passport. In reality, GantCrab had some routines which checked if the systems were set to Russian time zone or Russian letters by default, to prevent infecting Russian systems, because Russian IT security foreign policy is about dear hackers, the internet. You can hack the internet as much as you want, and we will not extradite you. But if you hack in Russia, then you will go to Russian jail, and even Russian hackers don't want to go to a Russian jail. So they make sure that they don't infect their fellow countrymen, real patriots. Brian Krebs has uncovered this group and wrote a very interesting article about it a few weeks after we did this little funny discovery. Of course, you know the motto of each Congress is no backup, no mercy, and you have to protect yourselves against these kinds of attacks, so that you, by having backups and not having to pay.
So what I think is very interesting is that these kinds of attacks with macros have been working ever since, basically, since 1999, and it didn't really develop since then. It didn't change. Every other bug, every other problem we have, we find a solution for. That one, we just sit through it. So I thought about it and took a look at it. Why do these attacks work? So I found two ways to kind of explain this. One of them is both are psychological. One is organizational psychology, and the other one is individual psychology. So Daniel Kahneman, who I think got a Nobel Prize, thought about how do people think. Thinking Fast and Slow is the book he wrote. So people, one of the first system is people think fast and intuitively and kind of automatically. If that happens when you're scared or bored, so, for example, when you leave your home, you don't have to think about how you close the door or lock the door. You just do it because it's so natural to you, it's boring. So this is the first system, which is primarily active when we're scared and have to act fast, or when we're bored and act like we always do. And most of these phishing scenarios go either of these directions. Either they try to scare us, or they try to act upon some movement we do or some procedure we do that we've done so often that it just gets us bored. And the other one is the system two, that's our analytical, slower thinking. So, yeah, but hackers act upon the first system. But what's the problem with that, really? Whenever we try to explain someone how to behave to protect themselves, we explain things regarding to system two, but that's not the system we act upon. I think it's much more interesting when we look at organizational psychology. We're kind of okay to have that IT perimeter, and we build up our walls and we're protected. And the attack itself is actually, the technical attack is pretty tough, and we're well protected. Everything's very well defined. It's measurable. But then there's people sitting in front of the computers, and they work with it. And we don't really protect these people. We don't think about them. We don't train them. So we have attacks over social engineering, which is way easier. This is when risk management takes action. We perceive the risk, we analyze it, and we ignore it. So we've been sitting here for 20 years now, and one macro after the other pops up.
Göttingen kommt auch noch dran, keine Sorge.
And universities like Gießen or Göttingen, now it happened there. So management means to take responsibility and therefore do everything so that you don't have to actually take responsibility, but nothing else.
Und die anderen, was kann ich dafür, wenn der Nutzer falsch klickt? Wohin uns das gebracht hat, können wir jetzt eben bei den verschiedenen Unternehmen beobachten.
Okay, so we don't know what to do when the user does a wrong click. So how can we actually solve the problem? What are effective countermeasures? What can we do to have people trained not to click on stuff like that? How can we design our UI and UX to be less vulnerable? It's always the same processes that are being used. The dimensions where we optimize the resistance don't click, and in an organizational context, inform the IT so they can start countermeasures. So I'll show you two examples from studies we've done in this area, and I hope I have sufficiently done anonymization here. So the first one was in Asia with 30,000 people for phishing approaches, and there was a video where we explained it, and we checked how often this was reported to IT, and we have seen how often people fell victim to this phishing approach. So what we wanted to find out how to train these people regularly, so we created a plan. What kind of communication do we have? We can send them emails or spam from their own company. We can put posters up on the floors. We can do both. We can do nothing. We can offer an online course and then have a quiz afterwards. Quiz can be text or video, and I was assuming that video was probably better suited. And then we created all the permutation of that, so we can measure all these effects. And then we created a phishing, and in this phishing there was they were informed, hey, this was just bad what you just did, or a video, or both, and just one of the others. And then we did a phishing again, and now I'm going to mark in green what actually did something. So all the information, or everything that addressed system 2, nothing had any effect. You can have them do quizzes, nothing is going to have any effect. What had an effect was if they actually encountered a phishing, and it was slightly better if they've seen a video about it. Because when they actually are in the phishing, they actually learn something in System 2, while System 2 is active. So for the first data collection we did, we had a success rate of 35%. 55% ignored the email, and 10% went to the phishing site but canceled. So they maybe have realized that something was wrong. And one of my colleagues said, hey, that's not possible. We have to be able to get a lot better success rate. Let's check if they have even opened the email. We had a small invisible pixel inside the email, so we could see if they had opened the email. So if we remove everyone who has never seen the email, the success rate was 55%. So we had another problem. 30,000 people had received an email from us, and we said, hey, we are this IT support. And there's different reactions to that. We got a lot of emails from people who said, hey, I want to change my email, but there's always this video showing up. I want to change my password, but there's always this video coming up. And then we had people months later who, when they want to write an email, that they just search for the last email and then reply to the thread. So we were busy the next half year to doing IT support. So the result, all of these awareness things were without any practical effect. And realizing, having the experience themselves had a very strong learning effect. But these are very, very specific. So people learn when there's a password reset email, don't click on it. But if you send them an email, hey, can you enter your credit card information? They say, yeah, sure, here's my credit card information. And also the scenario, if you we've changed the social engineering tactics up, and phishing, you trained with them, but that doesn't mean they are more careful with USB sticks. And also these effects aren't stable. That means you have a learning effect for the first 3 months, and then it's going down. So if you're doing this again after a year, you're back to your 55%. So you can try to reduce the problem, but you can't remove it. That's what I thought. And until I went to the second study, it was an international study, multilingual, English, German, Spanish, and two others, 2,000 persons. And the first result was, if people reported and IT had reacted, how many successful attacks could have been prevented? And about 75% of the attacks could have been prevented. So it's great to have people asked to report incidents. And the other result was, what if on the first try, they had a success rate of 10%, and I was wondering, how is this possible? So I was talking really big results. I said, well, 30% is easily possible, and it's, we ended up with 10%. So didn't you promise more? So the difference here is, this company had emails, they had emails added to the subject for external mails. They just added a small note to the subject. And the other thing is, they didn't have password change in the company. So here's a website, put your password in, so they didn't even, they weren't used to that. So that they ended up working with their system too and didn't make the wrong decision. The second and the fourth try was only with the people who were phished in the first and third try, so it was like a hard refresh course. And there's a few people who are very happy to click. And we have ignored all the privacy rules, and that the accounts were the functional accounts. So those where it's part of the job where that you put your password on a post-it on the screen. So if you look at the trend, you have a reduction of 33%. That's wrong, it's 66%. So the 33% remaining, so it's 233%. So this is really good. Nobody in psychology believes me. If you have one intervention and you have two-thirds change of change of what they're doing. But if you look at it from an organization perspective, it's a great disaster because 33% are still affected. So when people come into a situation they're not used to, the chance dramatically goes down. So what have we learned? Theoretical learning is without any effect. What's important is your own experience. Abstract defense concepts is not helping. You need to show them firsthand. The learn effects are reduced. You need to repeat regularly. You don't generalize, so you have to vary your attack scenarios. and it's important that people call IT to report such incidents. So you need to be nice to them, and it's important.
So, but if you look at this, our goal should be that our IT systems have been built in a way that they are not vulnerable to that. And they have to learn processes, and maybe the user interface should not be like this new installation of macOS Catalina, but instead different, because we cannot rely on System 2, but most protective measures do exactly that. Microsoft Word explains you something, and it's your problem if you don't understand what we're saying, and the rest of what your computer does you don't understand, so here's the button, press it. And we can't work like this for 20 years and say we can't get a grip on it. But there's a way to fix the problem with Microsoft Word. You just deactivate macros and then the business just stops. Or to sign macros is a very simple code signing of macros. You can do that with a group policy. And I talked to an IT guy of a big company, and it's one of the few companies who did that I know of. And he said, well, yeah, okay, it took a year, and I have white hair and lost half my hair, but I'm really glad I solved this. And it's the only person who did that in his company, and he's hated in his company, but really he's a hero, and you have to thank this guy. And what we have to do is we have to secure our system one, and intuitive actions have to be anticipated, and we don't have to train the user to type passwords into browser windows, and we can't do it in browser windows anyway. And maybe we should just stop the free choice of passwords, so not everyone uses 1234 as the password. And it's improving slowly. You can sign macros or deactivate them, and you can restrict software to just have them installed from app stores. I know there are political problems with that, but from a security point of view, it's good if people just don't install some exe downloaded from the internet and execute macros. And with FIDO2 and hardware-based authentication, it slowly improves. Two-factor authentication is on the move. Increasing, and the world isn't quite as bad as we think, but I wish that our safe security measures we really rely on the intuitive actions. And if there's a browser warning, there's something wrong with the certificate, and well, they vanished at one time because let's encrypt came. But nobody understood them, and exactly the same. We have wonderful SSL, and it didn't work because of bad user interfaces. And now browsers just refuse making the connection, and that's a good thing. I'm already over my time. Please make backups, change your passwords, and I'll send you an email about that. And yes, thank you very much.
So thanks for listening for the English translation of Hacking Brains at the 36C3. Your translators were Pink Dispatcher, Mary and Tribut. We appreciate your feedback. Please email at hello@c3lingo.org and use hashtag C3T on your favorite social network.
Wenn Linus Zahnarzt jetzt einen Passwortmanager benutzt, benutzt Linus jetzt dreimal täglich Zahnseide.
Ich habe mir gerade noch die Zähne geseidet, ja, habe ich tatsächlich.
Yes, I was actually just flossing my teeth, yes.